Good evening, everyone. It is indeed my pleasure to introduce the first speaker of today's webinar, Dr. Mukul Chandra Kapoor, who is the Director of Anesthesia at Max Hospital, Saket. His areas of interest are cardiac anesthesia, anesthesia education, and low flow anesthesia. He has several publications to his credit, and he is currently serving as the editor of the Yearbook of Anesthesiology, the Dean Academics of the Indian College of Cardiac Anesthesia, and the Director Scientific Committee of the Indian Resuscitation Council. He's also served as the past president of the Indian Association of Cardiovascular Thoracic Anesthesiologists and the ex-chief editor of the Journal of Anesthesiology and Clinical Pharmacology. So I would like to invite Dr. Mukul Chandra Kapoor to deliver his lecture, and he will be talking on the perioperative acute kidney injury. Dr. Mukul Kapoor, please.
Thank you, Dr. Vimi, for the kind introduction. And thank you, ICA, for giving me another chance to talk to all of you. And so I will talk about something which is very common, and that's the perioperative acute kidney injury. It's very common because we are getting more and more older patients, more and more geriatric patients, more and more complex patients for surgery. And these patients tend to develop acute kidney injury in case we aren't careful about it. So what is the problem? See, the kidney has the basic physiological function, which includes acid-base balance, blood pressure regulation, water balance, waste excretion, and basically what all this work has been done is to maintain the homeostasis of the body. Acute kidney injury, which is also commonly known as AKI, and I'll refer to it as AKI during my talk, following surgeries associated with increased mortality, morbidity, longer hospital stays, and it actually increases the cost of healthcare tremendously. It's a huge load on our country also. As you may be seeing, multiple dialysis centers are opening up all over the country, lots of them free, basically to serve the population, because this is a major problem in our country. The development of acute kidney injury, AKI, is associated with an eightfold increase in the 30-day mortality of a patient, which is a major, major problem. What is the incidence? Incidence is said to be about 1 to 5% in hospitalized patients who come for surgery. And it is said that in the United States, as in the broad general category of general surgery, there's an incidence of 1% of patients coming for general surgery tend to go in for AKI. And how do we define this AKI? When do we call AKI after surgery? It's defined as a significant reduction in the calculated kidney creatinine clearance to less than 50 ml per minute. The most common contributor out of all the surgeries to acute kidney injury is cardiac surgery. And it is said that mild kidney injury occurs in nearly 25% of patients who come for cardiac surgery and may occur, almost 50%. And moderate kidney injury occurs in 8 to 15% of these patients for cardiac surgery. And it is said that 5% of patients undergoing cardiac surgery will land up with renal failure, which will require dialysis, which is a very, very big, big number. So what is AKI? AKI is basically a syndrome in which there's a decrease in urine output and an increase in the renal biomarkers such as blood urea nitrogen and the serum creatinine. Both of these are surrogate markers of decreased glomerular filtration rate, that is GFR. Using these markers as criteria for diagnosis AKI has certain limitations, of course, because it is difficult to diagnose functional renal insufficiency, which is actually characterized by oliguria and creatinine due to a reduction in the renal blood flow. So if you look at AKI in general, you can see that it occurs in sort of three phases, out of which the one which we actually see, that is acute kidney injury, is a small part of the spectrum. The major part of this spectrum is acute kidney attack and acute kidney damage. So how do you define each of these things? AKI is present, said to be present when one clinical criteria, that is urine output, and one biomarker of renal function, that is serum creatinine, are deranged. Okay, so it used to be called acute renal failure at some time ago, but today it is referred to as AKI because renal failure is actually a more severe form of AKI. Then how do we define acute kidney damage? Acute kidney damage is said to be there when renal parenchymal damage is there, which is evidenced by histology and by biomarkers of renal tissue damage. But you cannot see this dysfunction or this damage with renal function. As the renal function is concerned, you may not be able to see the biochemical change in the renal function. Next comes the acute kidney attack. Acute kidney attack, or AKA, is said to occur in situations where the kidney is at risk of injury or dysfunction because of exposure to conditions such as sepsis, major surgery, and nephrotoxic agents administered perioperatively. The most common classification used to classify AKI is the rifle classification. This is one of the older classifications, but even to date, people still use the AKI classification to classify AKI, the degree of AKI. So what does RIFLE stand for? So it stands for RIFLE. R stands for risk. It is said that the patient has a risk of kidney injury when the creatinine is increased to 1.5 times the original value and the urine output decreases to 0.5 ml per kg per hour for at least 6 hours. I stands for an increase in creatinine values more than twice the original value with a urine output less than 0.5 ml per kg per hour for 12 hours at least. And F stands for increase in serum creatinine values 3 times the normal values with a decrease in the urine output to less than 0.3 ml per kg per hour for at least 24 hours. Well, L in this stands for a persistent acute renal failure with complete loss of renal function for at least 4 weeks. And E stands for end-stage renal disease, which is of course well known. The classification which came thereafter was called as the Akin classification. Akin stands for Acute Kidney Injury Network, AKIN. AKIM network defines AKI in 3 stages, stage 1, 2, and 3. Stage 1 is again very similar to RIFLE, an increase in creatinine to more than 1.5 the original value and a decrease in urine output to 0.5. Stage 2 is twice the creatinine levels and again for 12 hours less than 0.5 ml per kg of urine. And stage 3 is when the creatinine increases more than 3 times and the urine output is less than 0.3 milliliters per kg per hour for more than 24 hours. The last classification which has come in, which is getting more and more popular today, is called as the KDIGO classification. KDIGO stands for Kidney Disease International, Kidney Disease Improvement of Global Outcomes. That is what KDIGO. And this classification has been formed by a consortium of various associations dealing with kidney disease. It has got similar guidelines for classifying and grading AKI into 1, 2, and 3. As you can see in the chart, you can find this more details of the KDIGO classification on the site, which is called as kidneyinternational.org. As I said earlier, mortality increases the moment a person develops acute kidney injury perioperatively. Once renal failure progresses and the patient becomes dialysis dependent, mortality rates rise by more than 50%. And this is despite the progress in the new dialysis technology. We still have a very high amount of mortality post-renal failure perioperatively. Now let's talk about the pathophysiology of perioperative acute kidney injury. If you see the highlighted areas, cardiac stress and ischemia, this is a major cause of acute kidney injury. It causes right heart failure, venous congestion, and can cause AKI. Acute kidney injury can also occur due to volume loss, which causes a decrease in the cardiac output, decreasing the renal perfusion and causing AKI. The same can also happen in severe vasodilatation and hypotension, as commonly seen in the ICU settings due to septic shock. Again, a decrease in the renal perfusion causing AKI. It can also occur due to inflammation and oxidative stress. The use of nephrotoxic medication, all these together, finally will cause oliguria, fluid overload, inflammation, and they have a system that they, the same disease further aggravates the disease by causing a counter loop mechanism. So this can further aggravate the perioperative AKI. Patients with even mild renal dysfunction not requiring RRT also show a decrease in survival. And this has been very clearly demonstrated in multiple studies. A modest increase in creatinine can negatively affect the quality of life and life expectancy of the person who has been affected. AKI prolongs ICU stay, increases the proportion of patients who require nursing facility thereafter, after discharge from hospital also. That means they require nursing care even after discharge from hospital. And AKI has been found to be an independent predictor of morbidity and mortality on its own. Why is it that AKI so commonly occurs? You can understand it if you look at the physiology of the kidney. Remember, in the kidney receives about 25% of the cardiac output. That is about 500 to 600 ml of the cardiac output is received every minute by the kidney. Out of this cardiac output, 80% goes to the cortical areas. And in the cortical areas, the PO2 or the blood, which is flowing through the renal vessels, the smaller vessels in the kidney, in the cortical area, that is said to have a PO2 of 40 to 50 millimeters of mercury. As it passes into the medulla, as these vessels pass into the medulla, the PO2 of these vessels go down because of extraction of the oxygen before that. And the medullary vessels, which is just 20% of the cardiac of the cardiac output share of the kidney, have a PO2 of just 10 to 20 millimeters of mercury. So very low content of oxygen in the blood, which is getting supplied to the medulla. So as a result, the medulla in particular is very susceptible to the decrease in blood supply to the kidneys. And this low oxygen tension, by the time it reaches the medulla, further aggravates the situation. The medulla extracts the maximum amount of oxygen possible from the blood. If you see at the blood which has left the medulla, 80% of the oxygen has been extracted out of it. If you look at blood being supplied to other parts of the body, just about 20 to 30%, depending on the part of the body, of the blood oxygen is extracted. But here in the medulla, 80% has to be extracted because already the oxygen content is very low in the blood. An increase in the renal blood flow increases GFR, increases the solute load on the kidney, and also increases the oxygen demand. So an oxygen demand supply balance is very precarious in the kidney. Slight imbalance can result in tubular ischemia. And if we try to use measures to increase renal blood flow, it can further aggravate the ischemia by increasing the solute load. Now, remember another thing, when I was talking about the blood supply, remember one more thing, the solute load. The solute load is a very important thing to remember. The solute load is basically consisting of chloride ions and sodium ions, which need an energy-dependent mechanism for absorption. So whenever there is tubular ischemia, that is the blood supply here is depleted or oxygen is depleted in the vessels here, what will happen is it will cause an ATP depletion in the kidney tissue, and this will cause destruction and disruption of the tubular epithelium. The walls, the tubular walls can get denuded because of destruction of the cells. And this further aggravates, it will follow, cause a chain reaction, cause leukocyte infiltration, so many other things will happen and cause further renal disease. What are the major risk factors to which which can contribute to AKI. Underlying susceptibilities are age, more than 65 years, history of chronic kidney disease, a male population. Then Africans are more susceptible, obesity with a BMI greater than 40, arterial hypertension. Of course, congestive cardiac insufficiency, hepatocellular insufficiency, all these also contributors, and also diabetes is a major factor. There are certain procedures or exposures which can also aggravate AKI or can make a person more susceptible to AKI. One is sepsis, hemodynamic instability during the perioperative period, major surgeries, severe burns, severe trauma, the use of nephrotoxic agents. Sachin Khetrapal is a wonderful researcher. He's of Indian origin. He is in the US. He's a great researcher. And he has written a wonderful document, which was published in 2009 in NS Physiology. If you look at this document, he has enumerated the general factors which are responsible for AKI, that is, which I have already enumerated some of them. But what is important is he has classified the risk indices based on these factors. So he has said that in case a person has one or two risk factors, it's a class one risk. In case the patient has got three risk factors, it's a class two risk. If the case patient has got four risk factors, it's class three risk. And in case five risk factors, class four, and six or more factors, the patient is a class five risk for developing or aggravating of AKI perioperatively. What are the major nephrotoxic agents we use, which are can be responsible for AKI in ICUs and in the perioperative period? Radioactive contrast, angiography done before surgery can contribute. Use of aminoglycosides, amphotericin B, NSAIDs, beta-lactam antibiotics, sulfamides, antiviral agents, cyclosporins, and ACE inhibitors. What are the general measures you should do to prevent AKI? First is identify high-risk patients. In such patients, ensure that they are not volume depleted, and in case they want CHF, optimize the renal perfusion and optimize the CHF. Ensure perioperative hydration, ensure good hemodynamic monitoring, and the correct use of inotropic agents to optimize the cardiac output, and avoid, of course, use of nephrotoxic agents. There are some recommendations which are published in the Annals of Intensive Care in 2016, which said very clearly, we suggest administering aminoglycosides when necessary with respect. In case aminoglycosides have to be prescribed, they should be given only as a single dose method. And there was strong agreement as far as the recommendations were concerned. And this also suggested that NSAIDs, ACE inhibitors, and angiotensin II receptor antagonists should not preferably used in patients who are susceptible to AKI. So what are the perioperative strategies to prevent AKI? Optimize the cardiac output, avoid depletion, I'm repeating this, continue to treat CHF, optimize renal function in patients with reversible AKI, use statins, hematocrit optimization. This is very important. A low hematocrit may cause or aggravate AKI, and surgery should not be done, preferably in patients 5 days after angiography. So intraoperative strategies, avoid anemia, keep hemoglobin at least more than 50% of the baseline value, avoid hemodilution, use atrial natriuretic peptide when indicated, use phenylalanine, optimize glucose level. I'll talk more about all these things in the subsequent slides. So what are the pharmacological interventions which have been recommended over the time about how to prevent AKI? One is glycemic control. Second is the use of mesiritide, which is brain natriuretic peptide or the B-type natriuretic peptide. Use phenylalanine, mannitol, N-acetylcysteine, anaretide, is ANP, synthetic ANP, or recombinant ANP, dopamine, lubiolytics, diltiazem, clonidine, slowed by carb, and not use vasoconstrictor or lubiolytics. So these have been beautifully enumerated. However, let me tell you very frankly, most of them do not work. I'll come on them in the subsequent slides. The basic aim while using a drug which increases the renal blood flow is to improve the renal blood flow so as to reduce the chances of a person developing renal damage. Now, one of the best agents, which the only agent, if you ask me, which has been used or said to prevent development of AKI is phenyldopalm. Phenyldopalm is a selective dopamine 1 receptor agonist. Its use is said and has been demonstrated to cause a reduction in renal dysfunction. But in case it is associated with systemic hypotension, then phenyldopalm does not work. So you should have good systemic pressures and then use phenyldopalm. It benefits by increasing the renal blood flow. The next way is to use natriuresis. And natriuresis, the way to use it is to use recombinant ANP, which increases natriuresis by increasing the GFR and inhibiting the sodium resorption by the medulla. Recombinant ANP or eneritide, which is the common trade name, used to treat acute renal failure after cardiac surgery, has been shown to cause a significant reduction in the incidence of dialysis after AKI. It is generally infused in a dose of 50 nanograms per kg per minute as compared to normal dosing of 200 nanograms per kg per minute, basically to reduce the incidence of hypotension. In renal failure, you reduce the dose to just 50 nanograms per kg per minute. Now, diuretics are very commonly used. Diuretics are commonly used, and the role of diuretics and the use of mannitol also as a diuretic is very controversial. It has been shown that a combination of diuretics, that is using a combination of mannitol, prosamide, or Lasix, and dopamine in a low dose together, maybe they benefit. But alone, mannitol or Lasix or dopamine, they do not work. But this cocktail has been shown to have some benefit. So it's a low dose cocktail of these three drugs used together. Now coming to blocking inflammation to prevent AKI. Pentoxifilin has been used because it's said to reduce cardiac dysfunction and TNF relief, a release in ischemia repair of proven injuries. And Lexizumab also has been tried, and dexamethasone also has been tried. However, they have not been found to protect against renal dysfunction after cardiac surgery. Another common thing with the last few years, which has been used very widely and basically abused widely, is N-acetylcysteine. A lot of people are using N-acetylcysteine preoperatively to block inflammation and oxidation stress in patients and to reduce AKI. But there's no proper prospectively done RCT which has examined the renal outcomes. And whatever RCT has been done has shown no benefit of using N-acetylcysteine. So what are the recommendations? The recommendations are that not to use diuretics. There's strong agreement not to use diuretics. Secondly, not to use bicarbonate, and it does not help in prevention of AKI. The third recommendation is not using any of these things, any of these agents along with this to increase the renal blood flow. Even if you see the recommendations, you even do not recommend phenyldopalm, which has got some amount of literature in its favor. Now, in case you want to prevent aspergillus nephropathy, then you have to ensure that you hydrate the person well using crystalloid along with the use of the contrast. And you should continue the therapy with crystalloids, that with the fluids, at least 6 to 12 hours after giving the contrast. Again, the recommendations again say that before use of contrast, very commonly cardiologists are using before doing angiography, they use N-acetylcysteine. And it is strongly said that it does not help before angiography. You should not use N-acetylcysteine. Now, nesiritide, which is used for treatment of CHF, that has been compared with the SIBO, and it is said that nesiritide use attenuates the peak increase in creatinine, decreases hospital stay, and improves survivals at 180 days. What are the other strategies? Patients who are at high risk of AKI, it is said that if you do a prophylactic hemodialysis, if their creatinine levels are already high, the electrolyte levels are high, it's better to do a prophylactic hemodialysis, and that helps. It is said that the mortality, when we compare groups which are given preoperative prophylactic hemodialysis, was 4.8% as compared to 30.4% in controls who were not given the preoperative hemodialysis. Now, coming to biomarkers for early identification of AKI, and what are the predictors? Remember that serum creatinine rise after AKI occurs quite late. It occurs about 48 hours after the trigger of kidney injury is there. So it is very difficult to know about AKI, which is likely to develop in the postoperative period. So as a result, we have been looking for biomarkers which are able to help us in early identification of AKI. So what are the biomarkers? Their biomarkers are basically proteins synthesized subsequent to renal damage. And lots of new biomarkers are being evaluated and have been evaluated. And in the last 10 years, multiple such biomarkers have been studied. Of the numerous studies which are there, most biomarkers do not fit the bill. The best biomarkers or the most efficient biomarker is said to be cystatin. Cystatin is the out of all the biomarkers which have been studied, it's supposed to be the best of the biomarkers. There are other evaluated biomarkers like NGAL, KIM-1, FABP, interleukin 18, beta-2 microglobulin, all these biomarkers. But all these, what is the problem with these biomarkers? The problem is these biomarkers are assessing one particular area of kidney injury. They do not assess all the phases which can cause kidney injury. As a result, they may rise in certain situations, they may not rise in other situations. As a result, none of these biomarkers is actually efficient as a biomarker, because the kidney injury has multiple phases: ischemia, hypoxemia, cellular regeneration, cell cycle arrest, so many things are there. So no true study will be able to look at all these phases of kidney injury. So what do the guidelines say? Guidelines say they do not recommend the use of biomarkers to diagnose AKI. But there is weak agreement on this. There's a lot of opinion that we should still use biomarkers. As far as the guidelines are concerned, they say the best or the strongest agreement is about monitoring the urine output and the serum creatinine to detect AKI and apply certain preventive measures. Again, so the problem with this is it's going to be diagnosed late. The role of chlorides in AKI. Chlorides levels need to be controlled by the body within a very tight range. And the chloride control is primarily with the kidney, though some amount of chloride is also controlled by the gastric tract, GIT, which was because there's a lot of chloride in the GIT. About 20,000 millimoles of chloride is filtered by the kidney. And out of the 20,000 millimoles which are filtered, 99% needs to be reabsorbed. So that is why it's a very energy consuming process. And this is a very important aspect also in as far as kidney injury is concerned. And this is the reason why balanced salt solutions were being recommended. Though there is some controversy on the recommendations of balanced salt in the ICUs, because they showed that in case you use 0.9% saline perioperatively after major abdominal surgery, the chance, see if you look at the dark bands, the dark bands stand for normal saline group and the white bands stand for balanced fluid group. So if you look at the rate of complications is much higher with the use of normal saline as compared to the use of balanced salt solution. This was published by Shaw in 2012 in the Annals of Surgery, and this was one of the major contributors why it was recommended that balanced salt solutions should be used rather than saline in the ICU. If you look at the graphs and see how does hyperchloremia cause problems. If you look at this graph. If there is hypochloremia, it increases the probability of death, but the increase in the probability of death is comparatively much less. But in case there is hyperchloremia, the probability of death rises exponentially. Just look at how fast it rises with hyperchloremia. This was published in Anesthesia and Analgesia in 2030 by McCluskey et al. And this said that hyperchloremia in the postoperative period is quite common and has an incidence of almost 22%. Now, patients with postoperative hypochloremia are more likely to develop postoperative renal dysfunction. And that hypochloremia is an independent predictor of a 30-day mortality with an odds ratio of 2.05, which is very high. Now, what happens when hyperchloremia is there? When hyperchloremia is there, if there is more amount of chloride in the content which is coming into the kidney vessels, it causes vasoconstriction of the kidney vessels and it increases the resistance offered by the efferent arterioles. As a result, it causes a decrease in the renal flow and perfusion. This decrease in glomerular filtration rate causes a decrease in the proximal tubular reabsorption of chloride also. Similarly, there's a rise in the renal tubular chloride levels. Apart from this, there's entry of chloride into the macula densa, there's depolarization of the basement membrane, and a release of adenosine. There's a decrease in the renal urine output and sodium output as a result. So again, back to the recommendations. They recommend, of course, the recommendation are very clear. Do not use colloids in the ICU. As per again, this recommendation, again, there's a controversy on this. Preferential use of crystalloids instead of colloids for fluid loading and preferably use balanced salt solutions whenever you need large amounts of fluid loading. Now, relationship between intraoperative hypotension and AKI. It has been found that MAPs below the threshold level of 65 millimeters of mercury is associated with AKI. So it is recommended that you should try to maintain mean arterial pressures more than 65 millimeters of mercury to prevent AKI perioperatively, especially in patients who are more prone to AKI. So this is the recommendation as per the guidelines. Maintain a minimum level of 60 to 70 MAP. And secondly, in patients who have got chronic arterial hypertension, you should maintain the targeted MAP above 70 millimeters of mercury. You should maintain the hemodynamics of the patient, optimize the systolic ejection volume based parameters rather than any other parameter, and avoid fluid loading, especially in the ICU, after hemodynamic stabilization. And in case you have to use an agent to bring up the blood pressure, noradrenaline should be the first line drug of choice. What are the consequences of AKI perioperatively? AKI does not only affect the kidney, it affects the brain and cause uremic encephalopathy, etc., increased vascular permeability, increased changes in the intracranial pressure. It can affect the heart by causing the cardiorenal syndrome. It can worsen the NYHA classification of the patient and increase mortality in patients with congestive heart failure. As far as the lungs are concerned, it causes fluid overload in the lung, increases vascular permeability, pulmonary edema, which is well known. It affects the immune system, causing a decreased cytokine clearance, and as a result, it can cause high clearance rates and causes impairment of the reticuloendothelial system. In the liver, of course, it causes liver inflammation, reduces the function, affects the function of the liver, and causes hepatic vascular congestion. To conclude, AKI after surgery is a major perioperative complication, and it is associated with significant morbidity and mortality. Preventive strategies are limited, and evidence of most interventions is yet not very substantial. The current approaches include deferring elective surgery until there is adequate recovery after a pre-existing knee injury, that is, in case it's possible, careful pre-operative risk stratification of patients, and considering less invasive procedures in those who are at greater risk. Thank you very much.
Thank you so much, Dr. Kapoor, for a wonderful lecture. Now, I would like to request Dr. Rakesh to introduce the next speaker.
Thank you so much, ma'am. We have a nice, very interesting topic after this perioperative acute kidney injury, renal replacement therapy in ICU setup, when, how, and by whom. One of the very important topic, as Dr. Kapoor was mentioning, at times these patients could land up in some way of acute injuries and needs to have some replacement therapies. And it is being taken by a very well-known person, Dr. Ranajit Chatterjee, who is a senior consultant and in charge of critical care unit at Swami Dayanand Hospital. He is trained not only in anesthesiology, but he also holds an MRCP degree from Royal College of Physicians of Ireland. He's also a trained intensivist, having a European diploma in intensive care. He has numerous awards from various academic organizations. He has many publications in national and international repute. He is also actively involved into various activities of Indian Society of Critical Care and other critical care societies, not only nationally, but internationally. I know personally, I've seen him, that he's a wonderful academician, clinician, and he conducts a lot of workshops on various aspects of critical care, including CRT. I think none other than can be a best person than Dr. Ranajit Chatterjee. So I request Dr. Ranajit to take over us on this important topic of renal replacement therapy in ICU. Over to you, sir.
Thank you, Rakesh, for those inflated words that you're using for me. Somehow I can't see my sharing of the screen. I don't know. Let me check. It is not coming.
So it will be at the bottom, sir. Green.
No, just that I have used, but it is not coming somehow.
It's coming, sir.
It's coming? All right. Yeah, thank you.
Yeah. So just make it full screen, sir.
Yeah.
Thank you.
So thank you so much, Dr. Rakesh. And thank you again for giving me an opportunity to speak in front of so many people out here. I think more than 62, 63 participants are here, including the faculty. And today I'm going to talk on a subject which I'm practicing in my own ICU for the last 11 years. And Dr. Rakesh, I learned it from All India Institute of Medical Science in 2003 and from your Aviate ICU, and I started it in my ICU in 2010. So, renal replacement therapy, when, how, and by whom. I'll basically speak on continuous renal replacement therapy here, which has been principally done by us intensivists. And I'll also try to make a comparison between SLED and intermittent hemodialysis. So the journey started with this man, Willem Kels. He's basically from Netherlands. And it was in 1945, he used the machine of the motor of the washing machine and the orange cans and over the sausage skins. He started dialysis like that, ways in 1930s and 40s. And in 1945, unknowingly, he did 11-hour dialysis, which is basically nowadays, like you can say, continuous renal replacement or a sustained low efficient daily dialysis, that was known as SLED. Unknowingly, on a 67-year-old woman suffering from acute kidney injury, and she survived. So that was the first successful long hemodialysis that was done in 45, and we are going today to speak about him in late 2021. These were the machines that were used by in the initial stages, and now we are approaching the new machines like this. So if I divide renal replacement therapy very, very simply, it is continuous and intermittent. The intermittent one is either peritoneal dialysis, sustained low efficiency daily dialysis or intermittent hemodialysis, and the continuous therapies are slow SCAF, continuous venous hemodialysis, continuous venous hemofiltration, continuous venous hemodiafiltration, and SCAF is slow continuous ultrafiltration. So basically, extracorporeal blood purification therapy is stated to substitute for impaired renal function, which is extended over a period of 24 hours. Whether you do a hemodialysis, a SLED, or a continuous therapy, it is dependent on these four principles: diffusion, ultrafiltration, convection, and absorption. Diffusion is basically the movement of solutes from a lower concentration area to a higher concentration. That is, a higher concentration to a lower concentration area. Similarly, the movement against pressure gradient is known as convection. That is, when you are moving something against a high pressure to a low pressure gradient, that is basically known as ultrafiltration. And along with that, you are drawing a lot amount of water along with it. So this is known as the solvent drain. So when you are doing convection, you are also removing a lot of water along with it. And absorption is basically molecular adherence to the surface of the interior of the membrane that is being used for these therapies. So on the basis of this, we can divide it into hemodialysis, where it is basically diffusive clearance from higher concentration to lower concentration. Hemofiltration, it is a convective clearance from higher pressure to lower pressure. And hemodiafiltration, where you combine diffusion with ultrafiltration. Now see, as you are removing a lot of fluid, you have to replace it to the patient. So the replacement is done by a replacement solution. So the human kidneys act by the method of convection. So this is more physiological, whereas hemodialysis works on the process of diffusion. And whenever you want to remove a lot of volume only, I'll come to that. In cases of CHF, you do a slow continuous ultrafiltration. You want to remove not only volume, but also some amount of solutes. You use either hemodialysis, continuous venous hemofiltration, or hemodialysis. And whether you want to, in a hypercatabolic state like sepsis, you go for a diafiltration. So as I told you, that as you are removing a lot of fluid from the patient, you have to replace it. So you can replace it, this fluid, either before the blood enters the filter or after the blood comes out from the filter after being purified. So when you give it before, it is known as pre-dilution. When you give it after, it is known as post-dilution. Remember, the amount of fluid you are removing, you are basically replacing the same amount of extra fluid to the patient so that the patient doesn't become dehydrated. So how do you give it? You give it 1/3 pre-dilution and 2/3 post-dilution. This is the way how do we give it. Because if you give it pre-dilution mode, it will lower the hematocrit, decrease the risk of clotting of the filters, but it definitely compromises a bit of convection. Just the opposite for that of the post-dilution. We basically give a mixture of these two. And we use a bicarbonate-based fluid rather than the acetate or lactate-based fluid. I'm not going into the details of this. The most important part of renal replacement therapy, when it is CRRT, SLED, or a hemodialysis, is to put a good catheter. If your flow is wrong, if your flow is not sufficient, the whole system will fail. Now we are using high-flow polyurethane catheters. The right internal jugular vein is the preferred choice because it has a lot of pool of blood in the form of right atrium in front of it, whereas many people use the femoral route. Remember, if you're using the femoral route, then at least go 20 centimeters inside the femoral vein so that you can avoid recirculation inside the catheter itself. And the sizes are between anything between 11 to 14 French catheter. So this is the anatomy of the hemofilter, where the blood comes in and they goes inside the fibers, and outside the fibers are the effluent that you are giving it to the patient from the machine. And this exchange takes place either by diffusive clearance or by convective clearance, and the effluent comes in. The filters that we use nowadays are synthetic membranes. Way before the 1980s, it was unmodified cellulose, and we are using these membranes are very biocompatible, and they have a large pore size and surface area. So absorption capacity of these membranes are very good. But remember, if these membranes are not coated by polyethylene amine, then they might cause sudden hypotension and pulmonary congestion when you start the replacement therapy. This is especially in those patients who are having severe acidosis or whose circuit has been primed with the help of a bank plug or who are on ACE inhibitors. So you have to remember this sudden drop of hypotension and pulmonary congestion. This is also known as bradykinin release syndrome. In order to keep the filter, which is very costly to patent, we have to use some amount of anticoagulant, especially in CRRT. It is optional for SLED and hemodialysis. We use ultrafiltration. We use unfractionated heparin here, and the dose is around 5 to 10 units per kg per hour. Nowadays, we are using citrate, and they are basically doing a regional anticoagulation inside the machine itself, inside the filter in the machine, so that doesn't hamper much of our systemic coagulation. But again, itself is a big chapter. We have to remember that we have to go for some amount of anticoagulants. We may avoid anticoagulant by giving some amount of fluid flushes, saline flushes in between, and we can avoid anticoagulation, especially in patients of severe sepsis, where coagulation is a major factor in the pathophysiology. So the basic broad recommendations are anuria, aliguria, severe metabolic acidosis, hyperazotinemia, hyperkalemia, signs of uremic toxicity, hyperthermia. Remember, when you are doing CRRT, there's a lot of hypotension, hypokalemia, and hypophosphatemia. These three things happen. And we have to remember about those. Anasarca or a severe fluid overload and multiple organ failure. Any one of these indications suggests, any two strongly suggest, any three indications mandate initiation of mineral replacement therapy. This is older definition and come to the newer ones. So now the paradigm is basically changing, you know. We are not talking about renal replacement. We are talking in a broader term of renal support. Whereas renal replacement was replacing the renal function, depends on biochemical markers, as Dr. Kapoor was saying. And nowadays, we are using NGALS. You know, I am using it for the last couple of years, NGALS, NephroCheck, which is basically a product of TIMP2 and IGFBP7, has come in the market. Very good value of urinary values of the cell cycle arrest markers, more than 0.3, suggests that your patient is moving towards severe AKI. So these markers are in use. I think the guidelines will come up in the couple of years where they include these markers into the definition of AKI. So now from there, from the renal replacement, we're moving towards renal support, where basically we are thinking about cytokine removal. We are thinking about fluid removal in congestive heart failure, about treatment of respiratory acidosis in ARDS, I'll show it to you, and fluid management in multi-organ failure. So where basically you use CRRT specifically, especially patients who are hemodynamically unstable, you want a precise volume control, drop-by-drop volume control, and very effective in controlling uremia and increased potassium. Rapid control of metabolic acidosis, safe in brain injuries, diuretic resistant pulmonary embolism. I'll show you a video of that. May have an effect on adjuvant therapy in sepsis and definite advantage in terms of renal recovery. So nowadays, we are basically in the ICUs, you're thinking of conservative fluid management. We also call it a fancy term, de-resuscitation. As Dr. Kapoor has already shown, that kidney injury is not only due to hypovolemia, it is also due to pulmonary due to congestion also, and this effect of fluid overload, it affects more or less every organ system. And this is one of the multiple papers, one of the very good papers I'm talking about, it came in 2009, where they did a comparison between our adequate initial fluid resuscitation and a conservative late fluid management, and they found that the mortality with a conservative late fluid management was 18.1%. Whereas it was 41.9% if you are not going for any conservative late fluid management. So how we are going to remove this fluid? There are many theories that came up. This was the Koderman's approach in 2012. He told that when a patient is on ventilator, give a bit of air, the patient is in ARDS, give good amount of P, and this shifts the fluid from the alveoli to the interstitial. Give albumin. Create a hypertonic environment inside the capillaries so that from the interstitial the fluid comes to the capillaries, and give Lasix so that it can remove it from the body. So this was a theory that was been given. However, papers like this also came up, and there are many are coming up. I can't show most of them, just showing one of them, where renal replacement therapy has been used to remove this extra fluid, and they have been found to decrease the intrinsic pressure, the global end diastolic volume, and the lung water, extravascular lung water. So that also has shown an improvement in mortality. Similarly, patients who are on cerebral edema from acute liver failure, especially young patients, and hemodynamically unstable patients where you have the patient is in renal failure, the ammonia is going up to 150, more than 150, along with have, if you have SIRS, use a CRRT here. Especially, we start with continuous therapy, slowly, gradually go to a sustained low efficiency daily dialysis for around 8-10 hours. Then we move to intermittent hemodialysis when the patient is hemodynamically stable. And SCARF is a fantastic thing that can be done, especially in cases of heart failure. For example, a patient comes to you in the middle of the night and the patient is having severe pulmonary edema from pregnancy-induced hypertension and the blood pressure is 60. What you are going to do? How can you remove the extra fluid? So if you can do slow continuous ultrafiltration and take this extra fluid up, and the patient by around 3 to 4 hours after that, you will see that the patient, this pulmonary edema is gone, the congestion is gone, and the patient is hale and hearty. So it has to be used very, very efficiently. You can use it and very easy to use if you are using it regularly. And this is the new one that is, if you can, just before ECMO, ECMO has a huge setup you have to make. Along with the CRRT machine, this is basically a Jugaad technology, you can say, what we are doing. If you can attach a neonatal oxygenator to it, and you can do extracorporeal CO2 removal in those patients where you can manage the manage your ventilation with the help of a low tidal volume. So here, if you need a low tidal volume in patients of ARDS, you want to, from 6, you have to come down to 4, come down to 3, then what will happen? The only thing that will happen is the level of carbon dioxide will increase. We give it a fancy name, permissive hypercapnia. Why? Because we can't remove that carbon dioxide in any form. So as if we are permitting. I sometimes feel very funny. Do I permit theft? Do I permit robbery in my house? I don't. But why should I permit hypercapnia? We know that hypercapnia more than 70 is definitely increasing the mortality in patients. So we can do ECOR in this type of patients and remove that extra carbon dioxide from the body. And we can go to a very low tidal volume of 3 ml per kg body. Extravent study is one of them. This is one of my patients. You can see the machine is a very old machine, Prisma machine 2011. The patient came with severe ARDS following a delivery, and the patient was in AKI, ARDS, severe pulmonary congestion. Patient was on this Prisma machine for 7 days, taken out slowly of Prisma machine, went to sled, and then the patient was taken for intermittent hemodialysis for 3-4 times, and the patient basically survived. She is hardly a young patient of 21 years. Now she's happily married and is a teacher in one of the schools of Ghaziabad. So if you can see the 4 pumps here which are being used, I can't go into the details in 30 minutes, but definitely if I'm given a chance, I'll see. This is basically ECOR. This is the newer machine, the Prisma Flex machine. This is the neonatal oxygenator. You can see that what is coming. My enthusiastic resistor, with enthusiasm, she's shouting out there. This is the neonatal oxygenator. And through this, we are basically removing the extra carbon dioxide from the patient. ECOR, you can remove extra carbon dioxide, especially in patients of ARDS. So, and along with these therapies, you can add some amount of new filters, either in the form of cytosorb, toriumycin, or Xyris, especially in patients who are having cytokine storm or severe sepsis, or patient with a combination of cytokine storm and severe sepsis. So when to start CRRT? So as Dr. Mukul was showing, this was basically the Rifle criteria that came in 2003. See, there is a huge range of definition of AKI, you know. You see the 1.5 times the rise in serum creatinine in 7 days, or Akin criteria added this small addition, 0.3 milligram per DL increase in serum creatinine. That means if you are at 1.1 and the next day you come, it comes 1.4 and above, you are in AKI. So this addition was done in the Akin criteria in 2005, nothing else. And this has to be done within 48 hours or urine output less than 0.5 ml per dg per hour for more than 6 hours. So the definition starts from 6 hours, ranges up to 7 days. That is the definition of AKI. And this is the KDIGO that has already been shown by Dr. Kapoor, stage 1, stage 2, and stage 3. So where to start? In stage 1, in stage 2, in stage 3. So when I go to the KDIGO classification, they have not mentioned about stage 2. But if they're in the figure, you see they have very cleverly shown in stage 2, consider renal replacement therapy. So now different type of papers started coming. One of the Akiki trial and the Alien trial. And Akiki trial was basically, the Alien trial was done in a single center trial in Germany, where most of the trials are done in France. KDIGO 3 was taken as a guideline in Akiki, and they found that the mortality, that was the early. Early they considered KDIGO 3, whereas Alliance considered KDIGO 2 as a bit earlier. And the see the difference in mortality, 48.5% in KDIGO 3, which is supposed to be early for Akiki, 39.3% for Alien, which is supposed to be early for Alien. So the difference is around 10% if you are starting it in KDIGO 2. But the ideal ICU trial came after that. It was also a trial done in 24 ICUs in France, and they found that the mortality is around 58% when you are starting it at rifle 3. They considered rifle criteria. Alliance trial also considered NIGA-L as one of their inclusion criteria, more than 150 nanogram per ml. This was quite interesting because no study still now has considered any biomarker as one of the inclusive criteria in starting CRRT. So finally, this trial came, START AKI trial. And they didn't differentiate between KDIGO and KDIGO 2 or KDIGO 3 or RIFLE or AKI. They told that we are going for a standard RRT and an accelerated RRT. And the decision was left on the physicians. And they found when you are starting it very early, within 12 hours, when the patient is reaching certain criteria, and you are starting it slowly after some time, there is no much difference. They found there is no difference in mortality. So when to start? So Bagshaw gave this very beautiful chart. You don't have to think about the KDIGO guidelines or the stages. If you have the absolute indication, start it. If you don't have the absolute indication, see whether AKI is present or not. If AKI is present by the definition, optimize your resuscitation. After optimizing resuscitation, just assess the severity, whether it is Akin 2, Akin 3, rifle I, rifle R, rifle F, whatever it may be, or KDIGO 2 on 2 or 3. If there is severe, that is 3, stage 3, start. If it is in a milder stage, you see whether you have anything else with you, like rapidly worsening AKI, rapidly worsening illness severity, there is a hypercatabolic state, you have a severe sepsis, you have permissive hypercapnia as they are telling you, then you start your RRT as soon as possible. If you don't have any RRT, AKI also, you see the potential non-renal indications, whether you have refractory fluid overload, you have to be resuscitated, you have refractory septic shock, acute liver failure, you're stopping, tumoralysis syndrome, severe electrolyte disturbance, dysthermia, whatever it may be there. If these things are there, you can start your RRT then and thereafter. So now how to calculate the dose? Normally, the dose in intermittent hemodialysis by KT by V urea. They take urea as a surrogate biomarker for everything of your kidneys and fractional excretion of that given solute according to the volume of distribution is taken as the basically removal of this, the efficiency of removal. And the efficacy of removal that is given by KT by V is taken as the marker of the dose of IHD. Normally, it is 1.2 per day or 3.9 as a culminative one per week. But what happens in patients who are in ICU? Because you don't have a fixed volume of distribution here in patients, unlike the patients of CKD. Here, there is uncertainty in volume of distribution, unstable metabolic rate, labile fluid volumes. You may have a possible residual renal function which might come back. You have hypotension where you're using vasopressors. The situation is very messy. So here you just can't consider a fixed KTYV value to consider the dose of the RRT. So what we do basically here the effluent rate, the fluid that is coming out, that is basically the dialysate rate plus the ultrafiltration rate plus the patient removal rate. See, as I've told you, when you are giving the taking out the fluid from the patient, you're giving it back to the patient. This is known as a zero balance CRM. That is, whatever fluid you are taking out by ultrafiltration, you're giving back. But if you are taking anything over and extra that is known as the patient fluid removal. So their extra fluid, that is a negative balance CRRT that you do in SCAF, that you do in patients of extra fluid where you want to remove from the lungs, whether from the brain or wherever from you want to remove, there you go for a negative balance CRRT. Where the dialysis, so I can't go into the details of this due to the shortage of time. I can only say the normal value that Ramco started in 2000, it was around 40 ml per kg per hour. But quite a few number of studies like the ATN study and the renal study came in 2008 and 2009. They found that there is no difference between 40 ml per kg per hour of effluent rate to 20 to 25 ml per kg per hour of effluent rate. So the dose that KDIGO suggested and still now going on is the effluent rate of 20 to 25 ml per kg per hour. But this is that what you want to achieve. But you have to prescribe a bit more. If you want to achieve 25, you have to prescribe 35. Why? Because there are many much stoppage times. There are malfunction of the machine. Many things happen in between when you start a CRRT in your ICU. So you give a higher dose. You prescribe and start with a higher dose, thinking that you must be presuming that your patients, this machine will not function. Maybe you have to stop many a times. You have to change the fluid. So then only you can achieve this 20 to 25 ml per kg per hour. So that is the reason you have to require a higher prescription of effluent volume. So when to stop CRRT? This is a very important point. So there is, again, the guideline is not very clear, and nobody can say a particular specific point, here you stop the renal replacement therapy. What we do basically, when the renal function comes back, the creatinine coming down, the urine output coming up, a goody-goody stage is appearing every time with the patient, and the hemodynamically the patient is becoming stable, we slowly shift the patient from the CRRT to the continuous mode to a sustained low efficiency dialysis mode. And from there, maybe some days of intermittent hemodialysis. And then we take out the patient from CRRT. This is the way you have to do it. It's just like a wave that is goes on. So listening a bit easy, but when you start doing it, it will take some time. I think many of you are doing it who are sitting here, many experienced persons are there. They must be keeping their views also. Now, if I compare these two, this CRRT with ISD and SLED. See, there are a lot of papers on CRRT. Unfortunately, the number of papers, number of studies on SLED are less. And in a critically ill patient, it is very difficult to compare two modalities. Rakesh, is doing a lot of work on resuscitation, on CPR. So how can you do a randomized controlled trial on patients who are having a cardiac arrest? Very difficult to compare to patients there who are acutely managing the patient. So they're doing a randomized controlled trial and coming into a definite conclusion is very difficult. Observation has to be given a lot of importance here, because a lot of factors are there, not only the kidneys. So there is all of the organs are involved when the patient goes into sepsis or into a multi-organ failure. So CRRT is basically physiological because it is using convective clearance. You can give it 24-hour support. In the initial stages, why should I keep the kidney not being supported for 24 hours when it is not working? Why should I give a gap of 12 hours? I don't understand the logic. So in the initial stages, we can give a 24-hour support to the kidneys. It's very slow, very smooth. With IHD, there is a lot of intercompartmental shifts. So that is the reason of dialysis, basically Grimm syndrome. So that is not there. So that is the reason it causes a lot of hemodynamic stability, especially in patients who are hemodynamically unstable. The dosing you have to understand is very clear here. In SLED, the dosing is not at all mentioned in AKI. Also in IHD, it is quite confusing. There is effective volume removal, as that was telling it, which is you can do it in SLED F, where you are doing a bit of filtration. But in IHD, where it's a diffusive clearance, this effective point-by-point volume removal and replacement is not there. Similarly, patients of cerebral and pulmonary edema, and definitely it has an age on renal recovery. I can't show you the papers due to shortage of time. Remember, when you're using CRRT, this antibiotic will itself take around 30 minutes of time. Only one thing I can tell you, the hydrophilic drugs have a limited volume of distribution and small protein binding. They're cleared by CRRT. Never, never compromise with your loading dose. It is the maintenance dose that is only to be altered. And if you are increasing your filtration fraction, you have to increase your maintenance dose. Best way of approaching is the therapeutic drug monitoring. That cannot be done, unfortunately, for all the drugs. Creatinine clearance approach is also quite practical. It ignores the tubular drug handling. And the best thing is to, if you have this chart. If you have a chart like this, you know exactly when to use what in CRRT. We can use this type of chart we're using. And there are many papers, many books also, which you can follow. Similarly, when you're going for nutrition, remember the CRRT causes a lot of things are removed. This is basically known as depletion syndrome. You're removing amino acids, you're removing selenium, you're removing zinc, fat, glucose, everything. And in the cases of AKI, we don't restrict proteinase. We basically give more protein, especially in hypercatabolic state, maybe up to a tune of 1.7 gram per kg per day. Whereas the total amount of energy intake may be up to 30 kilocalories per kg per day. And proportionately, we give the fats and the carbohydrates. So again, it itself is another talk. So I can't cover the whole thing in this one. So this is about malnutrition and by whom. Now, this question comes again and again when I speak to Dr. Chatterjee. By whom? By an intensivist, by an anesthesiologist, by a nephrologist, by whom? I think after this talk, we can get your views. See, whenever we go, it's a teamwork. Especially in the middle of the night, you don't find a nephrologist in your eyes. Your patient needs a scarf. Who will go to do it? Will you call the nephrologist? He will come and he'll start your scarf. And in our curriculum, it is already included. Renal replacement therapy, especially in intensive care curriculum, is included. So if you are trained in this one, even by the Supreme Court guidelines, even an MBBS doctor can do everything, he is adequately trained. There are numerous court judgments coming up. So don't get afraid. Most of my anesthetic friends have asked me this question. I am an anesthetist, how can I do this? So never get afraid about this. You start. I can do it in my center, much smaller than yours. So why can't you do it? But again, I tell you, you have to go for the nephrologist, definitely. You call them next day. You have a chat with them. If you want to go for sustained low efficiency dialysis, definitely take their help. For ISD, definitely take the help of the nephrologist. That is not at all in our domain. But for CRRT, continuous therapies, and to a certain extent, SLED also, you can start it. You can, and definitely keep the nephrologist in your loop. But I tell you, awareness, eagerness, good teamwork and coordination, availability of consumables. You don't forget your administrators. If you can't convince them, you cannot start a CRRT. It's very costly. And receptive and encouraging administration, very important. And a standardized ICU care. This will only allow your patients and inspire them to live. Thank you so much again. I think I'm within time. And thank you again, Dr. Rakesh and the whole IEC team to give me a chance, an opportunity to interact with you. Thank you so much.
Thank you so much for running time. And within this time frame, you have covered so many practical tips. I think that was more important. And we could learn a lot from you, sir, as usual. You have given a very precise but extensive crux of your whole experience with regards to CRT in our patients. So thank you so much, and we'll take the question after the next session, sir. I should request you to be with us for next couple of minutes. Thank you so much, and I will request our next moderator, chairperson, Dr. Rashmi Jain. She is senior consultant and professor at Sir Gangaram Hospital, New Delhi. She has special interest and a vast experience in renal transplant, day care surgery, teaching and training. Over to you, ma'am.
Thank you, Rakesh. I would like to invite our next speaker, Dr. Rashmi Ramchandran. She is going to talk about anesthetic management of patients undergoing renal transplantation. She is a professor at Department of Anesthesiology, Pain and Pain Medicine and Critical Care at AIIMS, Delhi. Her area of interests are simulation, skill teaching, renal transplant anesthesia, airway management, and pediatric anesthesia. Over to you, Dr. Rashmi.
Thank you. Thank you, Dr. Rashmi, and thank you, Rakesh and Indian College of Anesthesiologists for giving me this opportunity. And I am going to talk about anesthesia for patients undergoing kidney transplantation. And it's actually, it was actually a big pleasure listening to the previous two speakers. And I would like all the listeners to keep in mind whatever these the previous two speakers had already told you. So intermittently, I would keep referring to both Dr. Chatterjee and Dr. Kapoor. And moving on to my talk, we all know that end-stage kidney disease is a terminal stage of chronic kidney disease, and the reported incidence in India is about 150 cases per million. The first successful live donor kidney transplant in India was conducted by Johnny and Mohan Rao in January 1971. They published a case series of around 5 patients. And it is the most common organ transplant surgery performed nowadays. It improves the life expectancy, the quality of life, and it has other socioeconomic benefits for the patient. So the indications for end-stage kidney disease leading to renal transplant can be diabetic nephropathy or hypertensive nephropathy. These are the commonest indications. And other causes, of course, include glomerulonephritis, polycystic kidney disease, chronic pyelonephritis, obstructive uropathy, and lupus. Renal graft failure is now increasingly being seen, with pediatric transplants being commonly done in India, and it is now an indication for renal transplant as well. So there are some common contraindications like reversible renal disease, active malignancy or active infection. Also, in advanced uncorrectable coronary or pulmonary disease, we would avoid doing a renal transplant. Some relative contraindications like age more than 70 or BMI more than 30 or sickle cell disease or a poorly controlled diabetes also exist. So why is anesthesia management so specialized for these patients? One is the patient profile. And we all know that patients with end-stage kidney disease will have multiple organs affected by the renal failure. Secondly is the involvement of a donor kidney. Now, a donor has donated his kidney, a well-functioning kidney, for the recipient, and we do not want it to go to waste. And third is the importance of perioperative hemodynamics in delaying the, preventing the delayed graft function. And as anesthetists, we are in charge of the perioperative hemodynamics. So the anesthesia management will be covered in these few points, which include the preoperative evaluation, induction of anesthesia, monitoring, intraoperative hemodynamics and fluid therapy, and maintenance and reversal of anesthesia. So preoperative evaluation will include a multidisciplinary evaluation. The patients would always be evaluated previously by a team of cardiologists, a team of nephrologists, a pulmonologist. Everyone would have already evaluated the patient once we get to take a look at the patient. So we focus on the multi-organ manifestations of the end-stage renal disease. We focus on the dialysis-related issues. And as I always tell my residents, that another preoperative evaluation, a new look, has always to be given immediately before the surgery. That is on the morning of the surgery. So when we do a multi-organ examination, the patient, as I said, is already evaluated. What we need to specifically look at is the hypertension. The hypertension could be the cause or effect of the kidney disease. So what the duration of hypertension, the drugs the patient is on, and the control that the patient is having, the coronary artery disease, which is usually the effect of kidney disease, the cardiomyopathy, the heart failure, if the patient previously had heart failure or is persistently having heart failure, the arrhythmias, the pericarditis or pericardial effusion or pericardial tamponade, and the patients will always have some amount of accelerated atherosclerosis. The hematologic concerns will include anemia, lymphocytopenia, bleeding diathesis. They are always increased. There is always increased susceptibility to infection. There is leukopenia and there is thrombocytopenia. So the issues related to the fluid and electrolyte management include volume expansion or volume depletion, hyponatremia, hyperkalemia, hyperphosphatemia, and acidosis. Now, all these things that I'm enumerating have to be seen when you do the first visit of the patient. And these things need to be evaluated extensively, keeping in mind the type of anesthesia that the patient will be getting. The central nervous system evaluation will include the presence of seizures, whether the patient is on drugs for these seizures and how is the control, whether the patient is having any impaired mentation, any neuropathy, any myopathy, myoclonus, or cramps, and of course, renal osteodystrophy is always associated with kidney disease. In the respiratory system, specifically look for or specifically examine for effusions, fluid overload, presence of heart failure, or uremic lung. And for in the GIT, assess whether the patient needs a rapid sequence induction. And if the patient is on anti-ulcer management, he needs to continue all this perioperatively. So Dr. Chatterjee has told us very detail about the dialysis-related issues. We need to know what type of dialysis the patient is undergoing, what is the access, what is the present access, what were the previous accesses the patient had, and any related complications that the patient has had, whether the patient has had any, has developed any aneurysm related to the fistula, or he has developed any thrombus related to the dialysis catheters that were inserted. The patient could also be having any myopathy. He could give history of dialysis disequilibrium syndrome. He could give history of hypotension or arrhythmias. The patient may have ascites or peritonitis associated with peritoneal dialysis. And dialysis can usually lead to thrombocytopenia. And a close look, we also need to know about the native urine output of the patient. Now, all these things will tell us a little bit about the patient's volume status as well when he comes to us on the morning of surgery. So the investigations will include the hemogram, including the platelet counts, the blood sugar profile, electrolytes, any acidosis, urea creatinine, of course, a baseline liver function test, and coagulation. Imaging would include all these things, inclusive of chest X-ray. The Doppler study would usually be done for IJVs, femorals, and the iliac vessels. And in the echocardiography, look specifically for left ventricular hypertrophy, cardiomyopathy, diastolic dysfunction, regional wall motion abnormality, and the status of the pericardium. We can advise some non-invasive ischemia tests as well if there are multiple risk factors like known cardiovascular disease, diabetes mellitus, or a prolonged dialysis, or the presence of prolonged dialysis in these patients. The second part of the evaluation or the PAC is on the day of surgery or the immediate preoperative period. So always go through the dialysis notes. They are very important. Look at the ultrafiltrate that was removed one day prior to the surgery. In our institute, sometimes the patient will come after double dialysis. So if he's posted for a Wednesday OT, he may have undergone dialysis on Monday as well as on Tuesday. So you need to keep a close watch on the ultrafiltrate that was done on both the days. Look at the post-dialysis investigations, especially look for acidosis, look at the sugar, hemogram, and in our institute, they routinely will undergo a chest X-ray and have an ECG post-dialysis. The plan for anesthesia is usually general anesthesia with endotracheal intubation. I will discuss the choice of drugs in a little while. During the planning for anesthesia itself, decide what kind of monitoring you need to institute, whether the patient will need invasive monitoring, and what kind of regional anesthesia, if any, you want to institute. So the goal for general anesthesia is maintenance of adequate preload while preventing fluid overload. Maintain the mean arterial pressure for renal perfusion, avoid hypotension, and of course, avoid nephrotoxic drugs. Just a little bit about the drug pharmacology before we discuss the drugs that will be used for anesthesia. The main problem with the kidney disease patient is the low level of albumin. This is because of multiple causes like plasma volume expansion, albumin redistribution, and loss in the dialysis. This predisposes to increased free drug fraction of the drugs. Also, the uremia leads to disruption of the blood-brain barrier, leading to exaggerated effect of the anesthetic agents. So keeping both these things in mind, we need to modify the drugs that we used for anesthesia. Also keep in view the volume status of the patient and the acid-base status of the patient. So induction agents that we can use commonly are propofol and etomidate. Propofol is a good induction agent, except that it is relatively contraindicated if you think that the patient is hypovolemic. A lot of ultrafiltrate has been removed preoperatively. Etomidate is an extremely good agent. It's a drug of choice. It keeps the patient hemodynamically stable. And unless you are using a lot of doses, it will not usually lead to acidosis and adrenal suppression. If you have decided to do a rapid sequence induction, use succinylcholine. The dose of succinylcholine is not altered. Otherwise, we can use atracurium and cisatracurium safely. Atracurium being a little, having a little lesser duration of action is safe in chronic kidney disease. Remember, cisatracurium is slightly longer acting than atracurium, but it causes no histamine release. Rest of the drugs you will have to use cautiously, vecuronium and rocuronium, and pancuronium should be avoided in patients with chronic kidney disease. As far as the analgesics are concerned, we know that morphine will have a lot of metabolites. Some of them are inactive and some are active. Their excretion is also renal, but they can be removed by hemodialysis. We can reduce the dose and increase the interval if you're using morphine. Fentanyl, again, is safe otherwise, but if it accumulates, it's non-dialyzable, but it is safe to use perioperatively in reduced doses. Other drugs that we can use is tramadol and meperidine. Both of them can be used safely, and with meperidine, we need to decrease the doses also, and remember that it is also, again, not removed by hemodialysis. Paracetamol, of course, is safe, and no dose adjustments or duration adjustments are needed with paracetamol, and NSAIDs are avoided. The inhalational agents that we can use safely are isoflurane and desflurane. Safety concerns with sevoflurane have now been refuted, and some studies have also shown that low-flow sevoflurane anesthesia is safe, and it did not alter kidney functions, even in patients with pre-existing kidney disease. Enflurane gives fluoride ions, and it should be avoided in patients with kidney disease. So routinely, we will be using standard ASA monitoring with ECG, non-invasive blood pressure, pulse oximetry, and capnography. If we decide to use invasive blood pressure, we need to remember the fistula sites. CVP monitoring is usually done to guide the fluid therapy. Temperature and urine output monitoring is done, and urine output monitoring being instituted after the kidney reperfusion occurs, and neuromuscular junction monitoring is prudent. Intraoperative concerns and other issues would include protection of the AV fistula limb, strict asepsis as patient is on immunosuppressants, strict fluid therapy, keep a very strict eye on the fluid therapy. There are some renoprotective interventions that I'll be talking about, and there will usually be a little bit of hypotension post reperfusion. So just a few minutes on fluid therapy. We all know that the goal for any fluid therapy during any surgery is to maximize oxygen delivery to sensitive tissues by optimizing the cardiac output. Hypovolemia will lead to vasoconstriction and inadequate perfusion, decreasing the oxygen delivery to organs. And on the other hand, fluid overload will have a negative effect on tissue healing and increase the risk of wound dehiscence, wound infections, and anastomotic leakage. So there are some static measurements that we usually use in these patients to guide our fluid therapy. The commonly used static measurements are the central venous pressure, the mean arterial pressure, the urine output, hematocrit, the SCVO2, and the SVO2. What we are usually using is the CVP and the mean arterial pressure. So the blood pressure, heart rate, central venous pressure, a careful history and clinical evaluation with consideration for ultrafiltration volume usually is a reasonable guide for fluid therapy. However, nowadays we are hearing a lot about the dynamic parameters to guide fluid therapy, which include the systolic pressure variation, the pulse pressure variation, the stroke volume variation, and the plethysmographic variability index. The other dynamic parameters are respiratory variations of the SVC and IVC, which the respiratory variations of IVC, of course, cannot be done intraoperatively, and the Doppler velocity in the LVOT. Now, a few studies have explored these dynamic parameters for guiding the fluid therapy during kidney transplant. So one of the studies says, which included 97 patients, it found no significant difference in the intraoperative urine volume, blood loss, and the length of hospital stay. Another study done in 2019, inclusive of 66 patients, the authors used a flow track based measurement of stroke volume variation. They also found that a total fluid amount infused in the two groups was similar, but there was a substantial intra-person variability in the goal-directed therapy. The authors actually encouraged a tailored approach that some patients may actually not require a lot of fluid therapy to have a good renal outcome. So the final word about dynamic parameters to guide fluid therapy would be that patients with chronic kidney disease have pathophysiological changes that can interfere in hemodynamic measures on which the goal-directed therapy is based. Because of the AV fistula, there is enlargement of the left ventricular mass, increase in the pulmonary blood flow and cardiac output, which can affect the estimation of the stroke volume itself. So the goal itself may be altered. There is early stiffening and remodeling of the arterial system, and this can influence the measurement of stroke volume and pulse pressure variation. And the role of actually goal-directed therapy in kidney transplantation per se has not been well established. Moreover, many of these monitorings are time-consuming, they are operator-dependent, and they demand training and might be expensive. So perioperative fluids usually are given according to simple goals, which include a systolic blood pressure of around 130 to 160, the mean arterial pressure of around 90, and a central venous pressure of around 10 to 12 millimeters of mercury. Remember, a transplanted kidney is denervated and lacks autoregulation, thus making the role of proper hydration and perfusion even more important. So moving on to the type of fluid that should be used for fluid therapy. So as I told you during the first few minutes of the talk, a lot of it will be going back to Dr. Kapoor's and Dr. Chatterjee's talk. So Dr. Kapoor has already talked about normal saline, and it was the first choice of crystalloid for kidney transplantation also, based on the fact that hyperkalemia can be caused by potassium-containing crystalloids. And it was the most commonly used perioperative fluid in kidney transplant in the US. However, high chloride content can lead to hyperchloremic metabolic acidosis, leading to hyperkalemia, which in itself can lead to renal vasoconstriction and decreased kidney perfusion. So looking at the constitution of the balanced salt solution that is available with us, you can see that the chloride content in the balanced salt solution is usually low as compared to normal saline, which is around 154 milliequivalents per liter. So any kind of balanced salt solution can be used. And this is a Cochrane database of systematic reviews in which six studies, inclusive of 477 participants, were included. And the most important outcomes, the risk of delayed graft function and the hyperkalemia, was not different in groups using normal saline as compared to the groups using lower chloride solutions or the balanced salt solutions for kidney transplantation. However, the other three parameters that the patients who received balanced salt solutions will have higher blood pH, will have higher bicarbonate, and will have lower serum chloride as compared to the patients who received normal saline during the transplantation. So moving on to human albumin, which is a common colloid usually used by a lot of us intraoperatively. It is supposedly having protective effects by inhibition of apoptosis, scavenging of reactive oxygen species, and proliferative effect on the proximal tubular cells. It is also said to improve the onset and extent of urine output post-transplant. The disadvantage being it is costly and can lead to anaphylactoid reactions. Now, this was a randomized controlled trial which compared the effects of intraoperative albumin and normal saline on early graft function in renal transplantation. And it showed that there was no benefit as compared to 0.9% normal saline. However, some centers do use it, and institution protocols may differ. This was another study which showed that 20% human albumin given intraoperatively as a volume expander also does not improve early graft function and its use should be selective rather than as a protocol. So artificial colloids, as Dr. Kapoor had already said, should be avoided. It has severe renal side effects, and HES in all its forms, regardless of the molecular weight, the substitution is harmful for renal functions. This same can be said about gelatin and extraneous also. So mannitol is also a very commonly used agent that we still use. We also use in our institute, and it is an inert sugar. It expands the intravascular volume, increases tubular flow rate, and has vasodilatory properties. It also acts as a free radical scavenger, and a dose of 25 milligram can be immediately given before vessel clamp removal, and it reduces the incidence of acute renal failure. A lot of us are using it during the donor management also, just before vessel clamping. So this study is a systematic review and meta-analysis, and showed that use of mannitol during kidney transplantation led to a lower incidence of acute renal failure and delayed graft function. As far as furosemide is concerned, the role is again controversial. It is usually given during vascular anastomosis to stimulate diuresis. It again increases the intrarenal prostaglandin production and increases renal blood flow, but it may disturb the protective corticomedullary redistribution of blood flow. This is a major concern with use of furosemide. It is, however, now being used in a few studies as a biomarker to predict the graft function in the perioperative period. So what about dopamine? It is known to increase urine output, and it prevents arterial vasospasm and reduces the incidence of acute tubular necrosis. So dopamine has also been talked about by Dr. Kapoor, and it, however, in this study, it did not improve the kidney function during postoperative period, but was associated with an increase in the heart rate, increase in the ICU length of stay, and 6-month mortality also. Many centers are now moving away from using low-dose dopamine for transplant recipients. Intraoperatively, remember that the use of blood transfusion should be done only when it is strictly necessary. The concern of alloimmunization is always there in recipients, especially pediatric recipients. And preventive measures such as immunosuppression, use of leukodepleted blood when transfusions are unavoidable should be done. The other thing that is important in the intraoperative management is the hypotension that occurs just after unclamping. This usually is because of graft perfusion as well as ischemic byproducts from the transplanted organ. So this can lead to a sudden decrease of the perfusion of the graft, and it is usually treated with a bolus of the intravascular fluids, decrease in the depth of anesthesia, or sometimes use of vasopressors as well. Unclamping sometimes can also be associated with acute bleeding. And if blood is needed, as I said, use leukodepleted irradiated packed cells. The reversal is pretty standard. Of course, there is an increased risk of postoperative residual curarization, and lignocaine or esmolol can be used in hypertensive patients for blunting the extubation response. Postoperatively, the monitoring should be continued in the PACU with ECG, blood pressure, the saturation, and the urine output. Supplemental oxygen is usually provided. The non-invasive blood pressure and the central venous pressure monitoring is continued, and patient's fluid status is maintained. Hypotension should be avoided, and nephrotoxic drugs, of course, are avoided. Analgesia in our center is usually done with the PCA or with the boluses of fentanyl. Morphine can be used in patients if we are confident about the renal function outcomes. Intravenous paracetamol is a very good agent. And regional blocks like paravertebral blocks or transverse abdominal plane blocks can be used. Just a few words about the TAB block for perioperative pain relief. There were a few studies in the literature about use of TAB block for perioperative pain relief in patients undergoing transplant. And most of them have given a favorable report for the TAB block with decrease in the postoperative use of opioids. There are a few concerns with central neuraxial anesthesia, including the risk of epidural hematoma because of the uremic thrombasthenia and thrombocytopathy. Also, there could be residual dialysis anticoagulation. There could be infection in the patient because of long-term immunosuppression. And the patient may feel discomfort during the procedure itself or during the insertion of invasive lines. However, the post-operative pain control can be managed well if the patient has a central neuraxial catheter. And no, if we are not giving general anesthesia, then airway manipulation and use of multiple drugs can be avoided. To summarize, kidney transplant can be potentially difficult, especially because of the difficult profile of the patients with the end-stage kidney disease. Though the surgical concerns regarding the surgery itself are very minimal, intraoperative hemodynamics play a major role in improving the kidney outcome. Judicious use of anesthetic drugs along with meticulous fluid therapy is very important in successful surgical outcome. Thank you, and I would be happy to take questions along with Dr. Kapoor and Dr. Chatterjee. Rakesh, over to you.
Thank you, ma'am. Dr. Rashmi, please. Dr. Rashmi Jain, ma'am.
Thank you, Dr. Rashmi. You have covered everything regarding renal transplant. I have one question. What is your trigger for blood transfusion?
So the trigger for blood transfusion remains, again, multifactorial. So if the patient has a, say, hemoglobin of around 9, 10, plus the patient is hypotensive, you do not want to use a lot of crystalloids. The patient has diastolic dysfunction, you would rather use colloids than crystalloids. Then we would like to give blood to the patient earlier rather than keep pushing crystalloids to them. However, if the, say, hemoglobin is around 10 and the patient is the cardiovascular status is good, then we can continue with crystalloids.
Okay. And how do you tailor your fluid therapy in patients who have dilated cardiomyopathy or poor cardiac reserves?
So again, Dr. Rashmi, as I said, then a patient with dilated cardiomyopathy would probably, we will be using some amount of non-invasive dynamic parameter measurement, maybe stroke volume measurement maybe using a flow track catheter. And of course, giving fluid becomes an issue with them, and we keep a close watch. We look at the file, we look at the dialysis notes, we look at the ultrafiltrate. We kind of judge by the history of the patient if he repeatedly goes into pulmonary edema, if he has history of respiratory distress intermittently between the dialysis episodes. Then we would like to hold the fluid and use more of blood perioperatively.
Thank you.
Okay, so we have a couple of questions for Dr. Kapoor.
Yes, please.
Yeah, so one participant wants to know why loop diuretics are not to be used for perioperative acute kidney injury.
Thank you very much. I think Dr. Rashmi also addressed this issue. It causes the differential. See, already the differential is there between the cortical and the medullary blood supply. And this differential is further aggravated with the use of loop diuretics. There are certain conditions in which loop diuretics may be favorable to use, but not in MPI. If the patient is hypervolemic, it may help. But in a patient who is already in established AKI, it is not
recommended. Absolutely.
Also, another reason is that it also the use of loop diuretic further aggravates the oxygen requirement, further increases the oxygen requirement of the kidney, because again, more amount of energy has to be spent to.
Yeah, absolutely, Dr. Kapoor. I think the jury is still out on this one, because what furosemide does is it changes an oliguric failure to a non-oliguric failure, which probably has a better outcome in the long run, especially in the critically ill patients. So if used judiciously, it can actually work towards a more favorable outcome. So it should not be used indiscriminately and in large doses, because large doses can also cause ototoxicity and venodilatation, which can exacerbate the hypotension. But otherwise, I think there are some reports or some studies which lead to the nephrotoxicity, which point towards nephrotoxicity of LASIX or loop diuretics. Okay, then we have
Can I say a little more? Sure. There's also a publication which has described what is called as a furosemide test. And the furosemide test says that in case a person is euvolemic, you can give 1 mg/kg of LASIX, and thereafter, after 1 hour, if there's an increase by 100 ml of urine output, that means it will likely to be benefit from that. But it also says that whilst the patient is euvolemic, you should replace the fluid accordingly. You should not make the patient go into hypovolemia because of this.
That's right.
Further aggravation. Of
it. Absolutely, absolutely. In fact, we actually use this a lot in our ICU, the furosemide challenge test or stress test, as we call it. And if the patient starts producing urine after giving 1 mg/kg or 1.5 mg/kg, if it's not a furosemide naive patient, then the chances of patient requiring RRT is much less. Okay, so we have a couple of comments from another participant who says that phenoldapam is not a very good agent, like you already recommended, and it's not available in India, and there is no documented benefit of using phenoldapam. And he says that the volume status and the mean arterial pressure are the only important points that actually benefit in preventing acute kidney injury. And then he also says that they did some study on the use of NephroCheck in patients undergoing off-pump CABG, and they did not find that it was predictive of renal injury. So again, this is something which is his personal experience, and I think there are various studies on this also. And a few more comments I would like to make is on the use of the fluid therapy, the role of fluid therapy intraoperatively in prevention of acute kidney injury. And the first is that with the popularity of the ERAS protocol, a lot of people are going in for a restrictive fluid therapy. And the thing is that a restrictive fluid therapy, if not used judiciously, can lead to increased incidence of acute kidney injury. And so again, there are a lot of people who actually believe in the use of restrictive fluid therapy, but I would say, and I'm not sure what Dr. Mukul Kapoor thinks, that the ideal would be not going overboard on overzealous transfusion, which itself can lead to venous congestion, and the chances of developing AKI is much more in these patients. So the ideal would be to use a goal-directed therapy. In an ideal world, if you have one, especially the cardiac output directed goal fluid therapy. And too much restrictive fluid therapy can also lead to increased incidence of acute kidney injury. What are your thoughts on this, Dr. Kapoor?
Yeah, I agree with you on this point. I very, very much agree with you. Goal directed therapy, yes, if you're doing major surgery, yes, very good way to manage things. One of the reasons I would like to add that, you know, when we were taught, I don't know whether some people are still being taught that way, the fasting period and the calculation of fluid for the fasting period, I think that is something absolutely wrong. And that is something which we shouldn't follow by overzealously giving fluids in the morning because the patient was 8 hours fasting, 10 hours fasting, 12 hours fasting. That is something which lots of people still follow. And that is why I'm mentioning it today. That's something which should not be done.
Absolutely. Totally agree. Yeah.
I think there was one more question which was addressed to me.
Yeah.
Somebody wanted to know if there's a seizure during dialysis, what should we do?
Sure.
So very simple. It's the same answer that any seizure, treat the seizure first and then after manage your dialysis. And it'll depend on the cause of the seizure.
Right.
rather than, you know, just continue dialysis then.
And the dialysis could very well be the cause of the seizure. So yes, you absolutely have to stop the dialysis. Okay, Dr. Rakesh, do you have any questions for Dr. Chatterjee?
I think my video is not working.
But your audio is coming, sir.
So all right. So I have to make some comments about this. Somebody told about the what is the vasopressor of choice I have seen.
So vasopressor of choice and diuretic of choice. We can take
the first thing. I want to make it clear for everybody here. I think everybody must be knowing also, dopamine is one of the very few 1A in the 1A indications of not using low dose dopamine is given in severe sepsis camp. We should not use low dose dopamine or to increase urine output. This is very clear. It should not be discussed at all in any forum, number one. It is जैसे हम लोग खाना खाते उस टाइप का हो गया ये चीज कि लो डोज डोपामिन तो यूज ही नहीं कर. सो दिस इज अ वेरी गुड वन इंडिकेशन, नंबर वन. नंबर टू, डोपामिन एज अ वैसोप्रेसर शुड ओनली एक ही जगह बच गया है. ओनली वन प्लेस इज लेफ्ट, दैट इज हाइपोटेंशन विथ ब्रैडीकार्डिया. अदरवाइज देर इज नो यूज ऑफ डोपामिन इन योर आई. स्टिल 2008 इट वॉज वेरी पॉपुलर. After some Debakey's study in 2010, from there on, non-adrenaline came into the account. Non-adrenaline followed by adrenaline. Now, vasopressin is coming up. After, there are quite a few number of studies that has come up. The VAST trial that has shown the usefulness of vasopressin. The VANISH trial that has shown the usefulness of vasopressin. There's this different type of studies are coming up with the use of vasopressin. So, non-adrenaline, adrenaline or vasopressin. And last is dopamine if there is, you have a chance of hypotension with bradycardia. Regarding Lasix, yes, furosemide stress is the only indication of Lasix inside ICU. Basically, if we give at a rate of 1 milligram per kg body weight, and after 2 hours, we see if the rise in urine output is more than 200 ml, that means this patient will not move into severe AKI. If it is less than 200 ml, the patient will go into severe AKI. We don't have any, because furosemide sometimes has resistance. It causes hypotonic urine removal, not isotonic as that of SCUF. And during hemodynamic instability, you cannot use furosemide. So these are the 3 points on furosemide. Regarding NephroCheck, it was told that NephroCheck, somebody has written that he has some experiences about it. The MARSH trial, 2014, on 50 patients, on cardiac surgery associated AKI, CSA AKI is a term that has been used nowadays. They have found that a product of TIMP and IMBP7 rose after 4 hours, and the value cutoff value was more than 0.3 with a very high sensitivity and specificity, whereas the creatinine and the urine output was not increasing up to 3 days. Cummins trial, 2019, there was a biphasic rise in this product during surgery and 6 hours after surgery. Mayer's trial in 2017, more than 0.4 with a specificity of 0.88 and a sensitivity of 0.77. Ozaker's trial, 2000, there's numerous trials on this TIMP and IGFPP. This is a cell cycle arrest marker, which has come up in a very big way in the circuit. We should go for it and we should check it whether it is also valid for our patients also. I think you should have a relook about this.
No, Dr. Chatterjee, it yes. may be very effective in actually detecting the chances of patient developing AKI, but the fact remains that it is expensive and it should
very
be
expensive, and you don't get it in India. Absolutely. Until now.
And it should be used only in patients who have a very high risk of developing a perioperative AKI. Definitely. Like in cardiac patients.
Definitely.
Otherwise, it should not be used in all the patients, you know.
Yes, Dr. Vivi, but I always say that nothing is precious in life.
Sorry?
I always say to my residents that nothing is precious than a life. So money is not a factor. You see, when you go for a stent and somebody, when the cardiac surgeon comes out and tell you, I want to put 3 stents, each costs you 1.2 lakh rupees. Will you go for it? So we always say, bhai, jaldi se karo, yehi kar do. So my point is, we should also be very fair enough about pricing when we are facing our patients.
The thing is that placing a stent is very different from diagnosing and, I mean, predicting the appearance of AKI. So it's not...
No, this is my example that I'm giving.
Yeah.
I think we'll take the last question to Dr. Rashmi Ramachandran, madam. So somebody was asking this, patients with chronic kidney injury disease can have coagulopathy. So how do you actually manage it if they come for other incidental surgeries?
So Rakesh, our concern is mainly regarding the regional anesthesia. So if the patient has come for an incidental surgery, we are supposed to give general anesthesia to these patients. Secondly, what kind of coagulopathy are they talking about? If they're talking about, thrombocytopenia, it can be replaced. If they're talking about, say, deranged PT, then we need to look at the cause and we need to decide whether the surgery is so urgent that it has to be done now, or can we wait for some amount of improvement in the coagulopathy to improve or to start the therapy and then look for the, then get the surgery done. But deranged coagulopathy, the regional anesthesia, especially the central neural axial blockades kind of are not to be done.
I think looking for the underlying reason for it, whether it is because of uremia or some other associated factors, look for the underlying reason and then plan the anesthetic management accordingly. So I think...
Rakesh, this person has specifically asked for cardiac surgery. I saw the question.
I just make it generic, sir, because our...
Yeah, so cardiac surgery, I just want to add one thing. As she has very rightly pointed out, find out the cause of the coagulopathy, treat. In cardiac surgery, there's a lot of problem because of hypervolemia. So there you have to, in addition to this, you have to do hemofiltration on the CPB. In addition to a normal CPB, you have to do hemofiltration. And very commonly you have platelet loss. And because of that, you have to use platelet transfusions and correct that. I wanted to add this particular thing.
Thank you. Thank you so much, sir, for the completing the question, in fact. So I thought most of the audiences were from general field, so I make it a general comment. So now, thank you so much.
Another point I want to add, it is not just the number of platelets that is important, it is the function, basically. So most of these patients, if you monitor the function, it is normal. If you do a thromboelastography and see, so they actually don't require a platelet transfusion.
Absolutely.
Dr. Rashmi, another thing is that although theoretically they are said to have a coagulopathy, but practically if you see, the coagulopathy is not actually clinically very relevant.
Yes, so that's true. Really don't hardly need ever need to give platelets.
Absolutely.
So the treatment is only indicated if there is actually a documented thrombocytopenia which needs to be treated. And so if the low platelet counts. Thrombocytopenia, of course, we cannot diagnose unless we have a TEG or... other values available with us. And despite all this, the incidence of epidural hematoma is extremely low. It's just one or two case reports that I could find in uremic patients when they were given epidural blocks. So however, just to be prudent, we need to avoid central neuraxial blocks and rather go for general anesthesia.
There's one question from Dr. Rakesh, which you need to answer. Rakesh has asked you one question. Do you follow CVP of more than 12 for fluid therapy as given in some books?
Yes. The values recommended is 10 to 12 millimeters of mercury, which kind of corresponds to around 15 centimeters of water. But as Dr. Rashmi also pointed out, in some patients, there is a lot of diastolic dysfunction. Some patients will have history of all these fluid overload and things. There, we would like to keep the CVP low. And then you need to discuss it out with the surgeons also. They would say that unless the CVP is high, the kidney will not function, the urine will not come out. And once the urine starts forming, then you need not worry about the CVP. So this kind of discussion, of course, will go on and on with the surgeons. But usually if the patient seems safe enough, a CVP of around 10 to 12 millimeters of mercury is okay.
I think today webinar was very special because all the speakers and moderators were having a vast experience of all the topics that we have discovered, done today. And everything was coming from their practical experience of last so many years, everybody has contributed. So I think it's 9:00. So I will request Dr. Jayashree Sood, madam, to give a concluding remark. And I would request Dr. Baljeet Singh, sir, to give a vote of thanks. Over to you, ma'am and sir.
Good evening, everybody. And as Rakesh said, definitely a very, very interesting webinar with a lot of interaction. I'm sure all have benefited from it. And yes, they're all very, very experienced in this specialty of the kidney. And they have had so many years of experience that it was all coming from their heart. And of course, Dr. Baljeet will be giving the official vote of thanks, but from my side and from the Indian College of Anesthesiologists, I would like to thank them all, Rimi, Rashmi, Rakesh, Dr. Mukul, Rashmi Ranchandran and Dr. Chatterjee for their excellent talks and the excellent interactions. So, of course, thanks a lot, and Baljeet will give the official vote of thanks.
Good evening, ma'am. So nice to see you, as always. Yes. As always.
Thank you. Same here, Vimi. Same here. Baljeet, are you there?
Oh, yes.
Hello?
Yes,
there. Baljeet?
Yes, I'm there.
No,
hello.
I know.
Good evening, everyone. Well, we come to the end of a very good webinar on renal disease. And first of all, I would like to thank all the moderators for an excellent moderation and keeping the discussion very lively. Dr. Vimi Rewadi, Dr. Rashmi Jain, and of course, Dr. Akesh Garg. To the speakers, excellent talks, all three of them. Dr. Mukul Kapoor started with the definitions and the classifications of acute kidney injury and what to do and what not to do. What are the preventive factors for that? And thereafter, it was Dr. Ranjit Chatterjee who spoke from his personal experience of dealing with these patients in his intensive care for a number of years. A lot of good inputs that he gave with regard to the renal replacement therapy. And then Dr. Rashmi Ramachandran on the anesthetic management of chronic renal failure coming for renal transplant, what to do and what not to do, and how to sail your patient smoothly through this period of surgery. And of course, to all the participants, Dr. Inputs. And before I close the session, I also would like to thank Dr. Rahul Chaube for live transmission on Anesthesia TV. And friends, that's it. Thank you so much for all the participants also who were there all through the session. And with these few words on behalf of Indian College of Anesthesiologists, I thank everyone. And goodbye to everyone till we meet again next Wednesday. Thank you very much once again, and good night.
Good night, sir. Good night, everyone.
Thank you, sir.
Good night.
Thank you. Thank you very much. Bye.
Bye-bye.